You're watching FJTN, the Federal Judicial Television Network.
I'm involved with the guidelines, originally, of course, as a judge applying them and then reviewing other judges' applications of them. But now, with 18 months of working on making them, I'm more and more aware of how extraordinarily complex this system is. We don't just pluck these amendments from the air, like I might have thought once upon a time, from the outside. We really do use the input that we get from all kinds of groups.
I think what that big book of amendments is, to the extent that it is a big book, it's our effort to be a little bit more surgical, a little bit more targeting as to the worst offenders. And at the same time, trying to create more discretion for judges to use if he or she chooses to do so with your assistance with regard to first-time nonviolent offenders.
Live from the Federal Judiciary Studios in Washington, D.C., the Federal Judicial Center and the United States Sentencing Commission present Sentencing and Guidelines, 2001 Amendments. Moderating today's program from the Federal Judicial Center, Lauren Woods.
Welcome. For the next 2 hours, we're going to explore the amendments to the sentencing guidelines that recently went into effect November 1st, 2001, with the United States Sentencing Commission. And joining me, we have Pamela Montgomery, the Director and Chief Counsel of the Commission's Office of Education and Sentencing Practice, along with Alan Dorhofer, a staff attorney also with the Education Office. Now, Pam and Alan are going to discuss the background and legal issues surrounding the amendments, but for the details on the amendments themselves, we're going to turn to the podium, where we have education and sentencing practice specialists Rachel Pierce and Krista Rubin, who are waiting there to provide us with all the details. Now, as with past sentencing and guideline programs, this program is also available for those people who want to receive CLE credit. Just make sure that if you're interested, you're going to have to read and follow all those detailed instructions that are available in the written materials that accompany today's broadcast. Now, those written materials, if you don't already have them, written materials and additional references are found on the FJC's page on the DCN. And that address is listed below is jnet.fjc.dcn. Now, we really look forward to your participation by fax. In fact, we are counting on it, so please fax us your comments and questions at any time during the broadcast. We've set aside time a little bit before our first break, well, our only break, actually, a little bit before that, and then again at the end of the program, where we'll have some time to answer your questions and comments regarding the amendments. Now, as I mentioned, our broadcast today highlights the key points of the 2001 amendments and resulting changes to the guidelines manual. What we really wanted to do today was to answer the question that a pre-sentence report writer might have, well, okay, so now what do I have to do differently with these new amendments? And in order to do that, we're going to cover five main topics of this year's package, as well as some additional other amendments Now, as you know, the Commission submitted to Congress the package on May 1st of this year, and that completed the Commission's first full amendment cycle. Now, this package was rather large, included 26 areas of guideline application, and resolved 19 circuit conflicts. By some account, this year's package could affect anywhere from 40 to 60% of the cases that are sentenced under the guidelines. So, Pam, you know, why don't we get this discussion started right away and find out why were there so many amendments in this year's package?
Well, Lauren, as you said, this was the first full amendment cycle that the Commission has had since it was appointed in 1999. During its first year, in 2000, the Commission focused primarily on addressing congressional directives. This past year, in 2001, the Commission's policy agenda focused on three specific areas. First, the Commission looked to address congressional legislation. Some of this legislation dealt with specific directives to the commission to make changes to the guidelines. Other pieces of the legislation had changes to statutes that required the commission to increase penalties and make some changes to the guidelines in some ways. Second, the commission focused on resolving a number of circuit conflicts. And third, the commission on its own initiative looked at a number of areas that our research and users of the guidelines said needed to be changed.
Okay, and one of those commission initiatives was the large economic crimes package. And Alan, why don't you give us some background on that?
Okay, Lauren. The economic crimes package, it was an evolving process. In 1998, the commission sent out a field test to a number of judges, practitioners, such as attorneys and probation officers, and realized that the 2F1.1 and 2B1.1 guidelines might want to be changed. In October of 2000, the commission sponsored an economic crime symposium over at George Mason Law School, in which we heard from a number of practitioners in the field and also academia relating to the economic crimes area. The amendments that resulted from this work included a lot of input from various groups such as the Criminal Law Committee, the Probation Officers Advisory Group, Department of Justice, Federal Defenders, and the Practitioners Advisory Group, as well as many other individuals. This amendment package had a twofold approach. Number one was to try to simplify the theft and fraud guidelines. And as you'll see, Kristen and Rachel will talk about the specifics of what we've done with 2F1.1 and 2B1.1. The second, I guess, goal of the commission was to try to get more low-level fraud and theft offenders into zones A, B, or C, and therefore give judges some more alternatives to prison time, zones A, B, and C, giving judges a little bit more flexibility in sentencing options. Furthermore, at the other end, the commission realized that they needed to punish more severely some of the high-level fraud and theft offenders. Once again, what the commission has done, and it'll be an overriding theme through the fraud, economic crimes area, and throughout the guidelines, is the commission has tried to punish those individuals that they felt were more culpable and caused more damage to both individuals and society with these packages.
Okay, great. And so we're going to start with the details of that large economics crime package. And for that, we're going to go over to the podium with Rachel and Krista for the details.
Thank you, Lauren. Well, as you have already said, the economic crime package was a very large package, and it contains a number of changes that will affect crimes such as fraud, theft, larceny, and property destruction, just to name a few. As a matter of fact, our fiscal year 2000 data indicates that of all of the guideline cases that were sentenced last year, approximately 15% of those cases were for offenses such as fraud and theft, the corresponding guidelines being 2B1.1 and 2F1.1. Of course, these two guidelines are going to be the primary focus of the economic crime package.
Exactly. And we're going to start off a discussion today with the economic crimes package by talking about how the guideline actually looks different. And the first change that you're going to notice right off the bat is that we have consolidated a number of guidelines. 2B1.1, the theft guideline, 2B1.3, the guideline for property destruction, and 2F1.1, the guideline for fraud, have now been consolidated into one guideline, 2B1.1, to address all of these different types of offenses. Now, because as a result of the merging of these offenses under one guideline, you will find that the new 2B1.1 has 12 specific offense characteristics, 3 cross-references, and 15 application notes. And it's going to be very important for all of you to read carefully through those application notes in order to get some understanding about some of the new rules that we talk about in the definition of loss, as well as some perhaps double counting issues as well. If you have multiple counts of theft and fraud, we have some good news. In the past, as you know, before November 1st, if you had a theft offense, you would go to guideline 2B1.1. If you had a fraud offense, you would start out at 2F1.1. Well, now, as a result of the merging of these guidelines or the consolidation of these guidelines, if you have multiple counts of theft and fraud, you're no longer going to need to necessarily compare the offense levels between 2B1.1 and 2F1.1. Instead, you're operating under one guideline, and so if you have multiple counts of theft and fraud, all of that conduct will be aggregated under the new 2B1.1.
That's right, Krista. Now, the second major change that you'll notice when you look at this new guideline is the creation of a new loss table. Because these guidelines have been consolidated, the commission has had to create a new loss table to apply to one guideline. Now, as you I'm sure already know, the commission has decided that loss is really the best proxy for harm that is caused by these types of offenses. Now, previously, in the loss table that existed at the theft guideline at 2B1.1, you started out with $100 as your first coming into the table there, and the table provided one level increments between your different dollar amounts. Now, similar to that table at the theft guideline, the fraud table at 2F1.1 also provided one level increases between the dollar amounts. That table, however, started at $2,000. Looking at this new loss table, you're going to see several things. First of all, you're going to see that the new loss table starts at $5,000. Secondly, you're going to see that we now have two level increments between these dollar amounts. And the third thing you will notice is that there's more room between these dollar amounts. There's a larger number in between the levels that you add each time you go up. And what this will do is this will serve to reduce the fact-finding that is necessary by the courts in order to determine the loss associated with these offenses. And that, in turn, will accomplish the goal that Alan was talking about earlier of providing lower sentences for the low-level fraud offenders and thus more options in sentencing for the court. And then, of course, the higher sentences for the higher-level fraud offenders. Specifically, you will notice at the $70,000 mark, you're going to have significantly higher offense levels and thus higher sentences for those defendants.
Exactly. And besides the difference in the loss table, I'm sure over the years you all have become very familiar with certain specific offense characteristics that existed in both the fraud guideline and the theft guideline. So one change you will notice immediately is that the specific offense characteristic for more than minimal planning that existed has now been eliminated from the new 2B1.1. And in the past, this specific offense characteristic applied probably in over 80% of all cases, but that now has been eliminated. There is no longer any adjustment for more than minimal planning. Another specific offense characteristic that you probably are familiar with is one dealing with mass marketing. And it had a two-level increase if the offense did involve mass marketing to a large number of people. Well, the commission has modified this specific offense characteristic by adding the number of victims that are necessary to trigger this mass marketing enhancement. The first prong of this specific offense characteristic states that if the offense involved more than 10 or less than 50 victims or was committed through mass marketing, you would increase by two levels. Additionally, there is a four-level increase, or alternatively, I should say, if the offense involved 50 or more victims, you would then increase by four levels. So that looks a bit different. Now, one thing you're going to need to remember about the application of this specific offense characteristic is that in order for someone to qualify as a victim under this guideline, they must have actually suffered some of the loss that was a result of the offense. And what we're going to do now is talk a little bit more specifically about the loss definition. As Rachel mentioned, loss is the proxy that is used to assess the harm that the defendant has caused during the course of the offense. And we're going to take a look at those definitions right now. Lauren?
Thanks, Krista. And that's pretty much how the program's going to work. We're going to do some discussion over here. We're going to go over to the table and get into the more details of the program. And that's how we'll run for the 2 hours of the program. One note that I just remembered, if anybody happens to be looking for slides accompanying today's presentation that is listed in the table of contents, note we were doing some last minute changes to those slides, so we're going to have them posted for you on the DC end by November 19th. Okay, but that does bring us back to the table for discussion. So Pam, let's talk about that new loss definition. What is so different about it?
Well, Lauren, the basic premise of this loss definition is the same as its predecessor. You use the greater of actual or intended loss. But having said that, there are some major changes, and it's very important that users of the guidelines read the application notes. The changes to the definition of loss are in those application notes. We give you examples on how to calculate loss in particular cases. By changing this definition of loss, the commission has resolved a number of circuit conflicts, and therefore it's important to you to familiarize yourself with this definition and how it impacts the circuit, the case law in your particular circuit.
Okay, now you mentioned circuit conflict, so let's step back for a minute and just talk about that for a little bit and the authority that the commission has to resolve those conflicts.
Well, back in 1991, the Supreme Court in a case, Braxton v. United States, said that the Sentencing Commission had the primary and initial, the primary authority to resolve circuit conflicts that interpret the guidelines. The court looked at the commission's statutory authority to review and revise the guidelines, and that it also had the authority to determine whether its amendment should be retroactive. And looking at all this authority that the commission had, the court said that it shouldn't grant so many certiorari opinions in these kinds of guideline cases, that the commission should do that. And since that time, the commission has resolved a number of circuit conflicts. And as you mentioned, the commission has resolved 19 circuit conflicts this past year.
Okay, great, thanks. But now back to that loss definition. And Alan, can you tell us, how did that resolve some of these circuit conflicts?
Well, one circuit conflict that has been resolved involves the use of gain as a proxy for loss, Lauren. There had been a circuit split that had developed over whether, when, and how it was appropriate to use gain as a proxy for loss. Some circuits had said that loss could never be used if there was not an actual loss in the case, and some circuits have said that loss would be acceptable in those situations. What the commission has done, it has clarified that gain is allowed, but it is allowed in only one of in one circumstance, and that is if, number one, there is an actual loss in the case, so the somebody must have suffered some kind of loss, and number two, that the loss cannot be reasonably determined under the calculation. So you need both approaches in order to use gain as a proxy for loss.
Okay, so the only time then that you can ever use gain or profit for, as a substitute for loss is when both of those conditions are met, that what did you just say? That there is a loss and that it cannot be reasonably determined.
Correct,
right?
And that's the important point, is that gain can only be used if, number one, there is an actual loss, and number two, the loss cannot be reasonably determined. If it can be reasonably determined, then you're going to be using the greater of actual or intended loss.
Okay, and now to get to that, that was another circuit conflict, right?
Right. It was a circuit conflict over realistic loss dealing with intended loss and whether unlikely or impossible losses can be calculated into the loss calculation. Some circuits had held that in order for a loss amount to include these unlikely or impossible losses, that anything goes. That as long as the defendant intended this loss to happen, whether it was realistic or not, that loss would be included. Some other circuits had stated that the loss amount could only include losses that would be realistic or that are likely to occur. I think an example might be the best way of trying to explain this. If I've decided to fake the fact that my car has been stolen, and I write to the insurance company, I call them up and claim that my car is actually worth $25,000 now, and I get paperwork and I get affidavits stating that I put some work into the car and now it's worth $25,000. Even though my policy may only cover me up to $15,000, which means the most that the insurance company would ever give me is cut me a check for $15,000, in this scenario, my loss would be considered $25,000. The intended loss would be $25,000, not the $15,000, which is the realistic, because that's the most that I would ever get.
Okay. So just so I can recap this case, if the intended loss here is the $25,000, even though the defendant has no chance of ever collecting that amount of money because the policy only went up to $15,000.
Correct, Lauren. Okay. And the reason behind this, the commission felt, was that this, even though they're unlikely or impossible losses, that this actually will account for the culpability of the defendant, because this is what the defendant is actually intending to cause, regardless of whether he has the opportunity to get that amount.
Okay, and now there was also some changes to, some changes to the calculation of actual loss as well, right?
Correct. Before we even go any further, let me try to sum up what the actual definition of loss is. And this, as Pam has stated, and I just would like to reiterate, these application notes are very important in looking at this guideline. As you'll see with this guideline and some of the other guidelines that we have redone, the application note is where these definitions and these instructions take place. So you cannot just look at the actual guideline without looking at the application notes. The application notes in this situation under the new 2B1.1 guidelines explain what the definition of loss is. Definition of loss, actually, the new definition is the reasonably foreseeable pecuniary harms that resulted from the offense. What this means is reasonably foreseeable pecuniary harm is defined to include pecuniary harm that the defendant knew or under the circumstances should have known would result from his actions. For example, the best way to try to explain this is a but-for causation standard, meaning that in this situation, when you look at the but-for the defendant's actions, would these losses have occurred? Now, this but-for causation standard is also working in conjunction with another standard, and that's the legal causation standard. This legal causation standard may work to put a stop on or put a hold on some of the but-for losses that have occurred. So you need to look at both the but-for and the legal causation standard, which will possibly limit the exposure that the defendant is facing with some of these losses. This resolves a circuit split that had developed over the years since the guidelines had gotten into effect in trying to figure out what's the causation standard. There have been three or four different causation standards. Now the new definition is the reasonable foreseeable pecuniary harm that the defendant caused or should have known he was going to cause. In addition, another circuit conflict that has been resolved has been over the use of consequential damages. In the past, the old guideline had allowed consequential damages specifically in two types of cases. Number one, procurement fraud cases, and number two, product substitution cases. And that was the only time within the guidelines that the guidelines specifically stated consequential damages could arise. A circuit split had developed over whether consequential damages could be applied to other type of fraud cases. What the commission has done, Lauren, is with this new definition of loss in the new 2B1.1 guideline, is we have taken out the term consequential damages. You will not find consequential damages, the term, within the actual guideline. However, these losses may still come into play in these types of cases, the procurement fraud and the product substitution cases, and sometimes in some other cases, under the reasonably foreseeable pecuniary harm standard that the commission has set up. So consequential damages will not be the term being applied by the actual guideline, but these losses may still come into account under reasonably foreseeable standard.
Okay. So just to, I guess, tie this up a little bit, actual loss needs to be reasonably foreseeable. Right. Intended loss doesn't have to be realistic, right? Okay.
Correct.
But whichever of these two losses is greater, that's the amount that you need to use in calculating the loss,
correct.
Right?
You need to, when you're working through the scenario facing you and facing the defendant, is you use the greater of the actual or intended. So you'll go through, look to see what the actual intended loss by the defendant and then the actual loss that was actually occurred in the case.
Okay. Now, both, Pam, both you and Alan mentioned the importance of the application notes in here. Now, do they contain anything else that we need to worry about with regards to loss?
Yes, Lauren. The new application notes contain several exclusions from loss. Loss does not include emotional stress, harm to reputation, other non-economic harms, nor costs to the government or the victims for the investigation or prosecution of the offense. These issues should be used in determining restitution and not loss. Additionally, the commission has decided to exclude interest from loss. This resolves another circuit conflict where some courts had included bargain for interest in the definition of loss. The commission has decided to exclude all interest for the purpose of calculating loss.
Okay, great. Now, is there anything else that we need to know about this loss definition, like credits, for example?
Yes, Lauren. Under what's called crediting or net loss approach, the defendant can get a credit from the loss calculation if he's actually returned some benefits, the value or services provided to an actual victim. The reason that the commission has set this crediting or net loss approach is that the commission felt that individuals who have given back something to the victim are less culpable than individuals that have not. They're still culpable and should be punished, but not to the same level as individuals that have not returned something of value. think a example might be the best way of explaining this. If I've tried to embezzle from my employer $15,000, let's say, over the last 4 months, and then today I've decided that I'm going to put back $5,000 of that amount. As long as I've put back that amount before the detection of the offense, then that $5,000 can be credited against the loss calculation. So even though I embezzled $15,000 at some point, prior to the detection of the offense, the guidelines allow for what's called a crediting approach. The $5,000 that I put back will be offset, the $15,000 will be offset by that $5,000, so the loss calculation would be $10,000.
Okay, so you run through that calculation first and then apply the credit.
Right, and the another scenario in which credits also and value that defendants had given back may lower defendant's loss calculation is also pledge collateral. In loan application cases, oftentimes the defendants or individuals will have to pledge some kind of collateral. If the defendant has pledged some collateral, the value of that collateral, depending on the fair market value at the time of the disposition or at the time of the sentencing hearing, can be credited against the defendant's calculation.
Okay, so here dates are kind of important, right? With in case of transferred benefits, it's before there was any sentencing, any trial, any even knowledge that the offense had even occurred. But in the case of pledged collateral, the date is either the sentencing date or if it had been disposed of earlier than that earlier date, right?
Correct, Lauren, and, okay. And you bring up a good point. The key point here is the timing. For benefits conferred to the victim and for value and property, you look to see the fair market value at the actual time of the detection of the offense. It's important to remember it's the time of the detection of the offense, not the date of sentencing. With pledged collateral, you use either the disposition, the value at the time of the disposition, or the sentencing hearing date, the date of sentencing, not the date of the detection of the offense.
Okay.
So timing is very important depending on the type of scenario you have.
Okay. Now, you've given us some examples before. How about in this case with both pledged collateral and transferred benefits?
Sure, Lauren. Let's use the case of transferred benefits first. Let's use a stock fraud scenario. If someone is trying to commit a stock fraud and at the time of the detection of the offense, the stock was worth $5 a share. Well, now, about 6 months later, the sentencing hearing date is approaching, and all of a sudden, the stock has gone up to $10 a share. The stock is now worth $10, an increase of $5 a share. Because these are values that have been transferred or values or property given, under that definition and that set of rules, you would use the $5 value. You would credit the defendant for the stock as if they were $5 per share because you're using the date of the detection of the offense. So you'd use the $5 as opposed to the $10. In a pledged collateral situation, it is a little bit different. Remember, you're going to use either the date of the disposition of the item or the actual date of sentencing. So, for example, in a fraudulent loan case in which a house is worth $200,000 at the time that the individual fills out the loan papers, says the house is worth $200,000. Well, person's arrested because of fraudulently filling out some loan applications, lied about the assets that he actually has. Bank takes the house back. Well, at the date of sentencing now, if that house is worth $400,000, you would use that $400,000 amount at the date of sentencing at that situation. And vice versa, if the house is worth, you claim the house is worth $400,000, and at the date of sentencing it's actually worth $200,000, you use that $200,000. It's the date of sentencing in that situation.
Okay, great, thanks. Now there's still a couple of more things to consider with the economics crime package, and for that we are going to turn to Krista.
Continuing with the theme that Alan was just discussing about crediting loss, we have to remember there are certain situations where credit is not given. The first of these is where we have fraudulent professional services. For example, someone is posing as an attorney practicing law without a license, writing wills, providing legal advice. Previous to this new guideline, some courts had decided that a value of the services that were given should be reduced from the loss amount. The commission has decided that in these cases, no credit should be given for those fraudulent professional services. The second area where credit is not to be given is where we have fraudulent regulatory approval. And this really gets at a public health policy issue. For example, a defendant may be marketing an herbal supplement and claims that this herbal supplement has been approved by the FDA when in fact it was not. In these types of situations, no credit should be given for the value of the herbal supplement. It may work fine, but no credit should be given for the value of these types of cases because of the public health issue, the public policy issues that are associated with that. Another area where credit should not be given is in investment schemes, for any profits that are realized in investment schemes. And this really gets to Ponzi schemes and pyramid schemes. And what I mean by profits realized by investment schemes means over what was initially invested. So for example, if I am running a pyramid scheme and I approach Rachel and Alan and ask each of them to give me $10,000 to start up my pyramid scheme. Rachel gives me her $10,000, Alan gives me his $10,000. Now, as the scheme continues, and what allows the scheme to continue is the fact that initial investors are receiving some sort of profit, some sort of reward for the initial investment that they made. So I return to Rachel $5,000 of the $10,000 that she gave me, and I return to Alan $12,000. So he has actually gained $2,000 from his initial investment of $10,000. Credit should only be given for the $5,000 I've returned to Rachel and the $10,000 that Alan has received from to credit against his initial investment. I should not be receiving any credit for the additional $2,000 worth of profit that Alan has received. So in those cases, you would only be credited up to the initial investment amount. No additional profit should be realized or credited in the loss calculation. There's another special rule for diversion of government benefit programs. Benefits provided to the intended recipients are not included in the loss amount. So for example, if there is some sort of Medicare fraud, if some of that Medicare money was getting to the people it was supposed to be getting to, that money should not be used to calculate the loss amount. In other words, in diversion of government benefit program fraud, you need to calculate the loss according to the value of what actually was diverted from the intended recipients. So there's some special rules there, and again, they're contained in your application notes, but you need to take a look at those when you're considering these types of cases.
That's absolutely right, Kristen. I just want to echo that again, how important it is to make sure that you read not only the new guideline, because it is a new guideline, it has some new specific offense characteristics, but also all of the application notes and the commentary, because there's a lot packed into it. As you can see, the loss definition has changed significantly. We have special rules, we have other things that you're supposed to include and not include, and you're not going to know about those things if you don't read the application notes. So before we move on to discuss some of the other finer points, changes in the Economic Crime Amendment Package, let's do a brief summary of what we've discussed regarding the loss definition thus far. As Pam mentioned earlier, the general premise is the same, and that is that the greater of actual or intended loss is to be used when calculating loss for this guideline. The actual loss definition, however, has changed. The Commission has gone in and reserved a circuit conflict regarding causation and adopted a new definition saying that actual loss is the reasonably foreseeable pecuniary harm caused by the offense. Another issue to be aware of is that intended loss need not be realistic. This was also a resolution of a circuit conflict, and the Commission decided that the intended loss, if you go with that amount, does not even need to be realistic or even possible. Another resolution of a circuit conflict, the Commission decided to clarify that gain is only to be used if there is a loss from the offense, but that loss cannot reasonably be determined. We talked about specific exclusions. These are things that you need to be aware of when you're doing your loss calculations. Loss does not include certain non-economic harms, for example, emotional stress. Additionally, loss does not include costs to the government or victims for the investigation or prosecution of the offense. Loss does not include interest. Once again, this is a resolution of a circuit conflict. Some circuits were allowing the courts to use bargain for interest, and the Commission has stated that in no cases is interest to be used in the calculation of loss. Now, it's also important to note that the commission has codified an approach to loss that has really developed through case law over the last several years, and that is this concept of a net loss, or crediting, if you will. And the commission states that it is appropriate in certain cases where certain benefits are transferred to the victim or the defendant has pledged collateral, and Alan talked about the time frames that you have to remember. And in some cases, it will be appropriate to give the defendant a credit where this happens. In the same token, however, the commission does lay out certain instances in which credit is not appropriate. In fraudulent professional services cases, in fraudulent regulatory approval cases, where you have a Ponzi scheme and any profits are realized by the investors in the investment scheme, and any benefits provided to intended recipients in a diversion of government program benefits. So, as I said, there are a lot of things that are incorporated into this loss definition, and so it's important that you remember all of those as you're going through your guideline calculations. Now, I want to talk briefly about a couple of more circuit conflicts that deal with specific offense characteristics at the guideline at 2B1.1. And one of them is the specific offense characteristic for in the business of receiving and selling stolen property. In the past, there was a circuit conflict over this specific offense characteristic regarding how to determine whether or not the specific offense characteristic applies. And some courts were using what is known as the fence test, where the court had to go in and make the determination if the stolen property was actually bought or sold, and then how those transactions then affected the furthering of that offense or allowing others to continue committing that offense. Other circuits, however, were adopting the totality of circumstances test, where you looked more at the regularity and the sophistication of the offense, so it was a little bit easier to make that analysis, and you don't have to make such specific findings. The commission has decided to adopt the totality of the circumstances test, and hopefully that will make it easier for the courts to determine the situations in which this specific offense characteristic applies. The second one that I want to mention specifically is the specific offense characteristic regarding acting on behalf of a charitable organization or government agency. Now, the circuit split for this situation regarded or revolved around the defendant's actual association with that organization or governmental agency. Some circuits were saying that the defendant had to really legitimately be connected to that organization or that governmental agency and misrepresenting something and getting some sort of benefit on the basis of that legitimate connection to that. Other circuits were saying that the defendant's connection or status with the agency or the organization didn't matter. If the specific offense characteristic applied, then it applied. And that is the approach that the commission has gone with, resolved that circuit conflict by saying that the defendant's actual association with the government agency or the organization is not relevant in determining whether or not the specific offense characteristic applies.
Right. Now, the economic crimes package does not just deal with the new guideline 2B1.1. The commission has made some changes to the tax guidelines as well. The first of these is a change to the tax loss table, where you can see that previously where the incremental increase under this loss table had been by one level, now the tax loss table similarly has two level increments, just as the new table in guideline 2B1.1. And again, this reduces judicial fact finding in order to come up with that tax loss range. Secondly, another change under the tax guideline is we have an instruction now that tax loss will be the aggregate of corporate and individual tax loss. And this is based primarily on the premise that they could be considered to be the same course of conduct or common scheme or plan as defined under Application Note 9 of relevant conduct. And then finally, sophisticated concealment, a specific offense characteristic that I had addressed that in the past, has now been changed to sophisticated means. So again, take a look at the application notes there under 2T1.1 and make sure that you understand that definition as well.
Thanks, Krista. Now that wraps up our first discussion on the economic crimes package. So I'm sure we didn't have time to cover everything regarding that. And if you have any questions, be sure to fax them in before, at any time during the program. We'll try to get to them right before we take our break, which will be in a couple of minutes, or again at the end of the program. But now, before we move on, let's quickly review the amendment process itself. Now, Pam, these amendments were submitted to Congress on May 1 and went into effect November 1. And in this particular cycle, Congress did not have to or did not modify or reject any of the proposed amendments, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And that's pretty much the standard time frame for how the amendment process works, right?
Yes, it is, Lauren. By statute, the Commission must submit to Congress on or before May 1st all new amendments to the Guidelines Manual. If Congress does not act, those amendments automatically go into effect on November 1st. Sometimes, however, Congress gives the Commission directives to enact a change to the guidelines outside of that normal process. We call this emergency amendment authority. And from time to time, the Commission does indeed have this emergency amendment authority. Congress may say, enact a change to the guidelines within 60 days, 90 days, some other time frame.
Okay, and does that emergency authority automatically become permanent?
No. Once the Commission promulgates an emergency amendment, it has to re-promulgate that amendment during the normal amendment process, that November 1st deadline that I talked about. Then the emergency amendment becomes permanent once it's been re-promulgated. Sometimes, however, the Commission may make changes in the permanent amendment. Something may look a little different than an emergency amendment.
Okay, and that brings us to our next topic, which is involves a lot of that amendment authority, and I think there are some changes between what was the emergency and what was changed now. So for those changes to the drug amendments, is what we're talking about now, we're going to go to Krista and Rachel.
The majority of the amendments that the Commission has made to Guideline 2D1.1, which deals with drug trafficking, and 2D1.11, which deals with listed chemicals, were the result of emergency authority, the result of directives that Congress had given to us over the past year. The Methamphetamine Anti-Proliferation Act of 2000 and the Ecstasy Anti-Proliferation Act of 2000 was the legislation where we found a number of these directives, and the Commission responded to these using that emergency authority. In fact, some amendments went into effect on December 16th of 2000, and others went into effect on May 1st of 2001. They've been re-promulgated and have been made permanent, and for that went into effect on November 1st of 2001.
That's right. Let's start by looking at the changes of the drug trafficking guideline 2D1.1. As Krista stated, as a result of the Methamphetamine Anti-Proliferation Act of 2000, Congress was very concerned about offenses involving the production of methamphetamine and amphetamine as well. And as a result of that concern, the Commission was given some very specific directives for increasing the penalties associated with offenses involving the production of methamphetamine and amphetamine. And specific, I mean very specific and very specific language, that the Commission increased by not less than 3 levels and provide a floor of 27 for offenses that create a substantial risk of harm to human life or the environment, and also to increase by not less than 6 levels and provide a floor of 30 for these types of offenses that create a substantial risk of harm to the life of a minor or an incompetent. Now, when you look at the guideline at 2D1.1 and you see these new specific offense characteristics, you'll see that what we've done is basically lifted that statute, or lifted that language, excuse me, directly from that directive and placed it into the guideline and the new SOC there at 2D1.1. Now, as Krista stated, this amendment originally was promulgated in December of 2000 under emergency amendment authority. And you may remember that there was a previous specific offense characteristic that dealt with the emission of toxic materials into the environment. So it was thought that maybe this might present a double counting issue. So while the Commission was looking at, in between the emergency promulgation of the amendment and the permanent promulgation of the amendment November 1st, while the Commission was looking at that, they decided the best way to remedy that would be to have these specific offense characteristics apply alternatively, because previously they had applied cumulatively. So now that when you look at the guideline, what you will see is the previous specific offense characteristic that deals with unlawful discharge, transportation, or storage of a hazardous substance, providing a 2-level increase. You'll see one of the new specific offense characteristics to provide an increase of 3 levels, but not less than 27, for the offense involving substantial risk of harm to human life or the environment. And the third specific offense characteristic that provides for an increase of 6 levels, but a floor of 30, for those offenses that involve a substantial risk of harm to the life of a minor or an incompetent. And the instructions in the guideline tell you that you are to apply the greater of these. So whichever is going to result in the highest offense level for your defendant, that's the specific offense characteristic that you will apply.
So prior to November 1st, it was possible to get the two-level increase for the unlawful discharge plus either the three-level increase or the six-level increase as a result of the directives.
Correct.
But now it's either two, three, or six.
That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
Well, in addition to those changes, Congress was very concerned with not only the manufacture of methamphetamine, but the manufacture of amphetamine as well. So as a result, all of the ratios in the drug trafficking guideline 2D1.1, you will find that methamphetamine and amphetamine are now being treated equally. And as the commission researched and as we learned from groups and from Congress, the manufacture of these controlled substances is so similar that in fact sometimes you have defendants claiming that they are manufacturing methamphetamine when in actuality they are manufacturing amphetamine instead. So you will see now that the ratios have been equalized under the drug quantity table or the drug equivalency table. Additionally, any specific offense characteristic that has existed in 2D1.1 dealing with the manufacture of meth now includes the manufacture of amphetamine as well. So you can see the concern that has been building over these controlled substances. Now additionally, we need to look at some of the chemicals that are used in the manufacture of methamphetamine and amphetamine. Ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, and phenylpropanolamine are now listed in the drug equivalency table in 2D1.1. What this means is that there is an equivalency to marijuana. So if you have an offense that involves these listed chemicals, 1 gram is equal to 1 kilogram of marijuana. So the conversion to go back into the drug quantity table is easier. And this especially comes into play when you have a defendant who is convicted of an offense that would take you to guideline 2D1.11, which would deal with the unlawful use or possession of listed chemicals. As you may know, there's a cross-reference at 2D1.11 that says if the offense involved the manufacture of methamphetamine or the attempted manufacture of a controlled substance, you should cross-reference out of the listed chemical guideline and go over to the drug trafficking guideline, 2D1.1. Well, prior to this change, there was no clear instruction as to the amount of drugs that could be created from these listed chemicals. And what the commission has based the marijuana conversion on, the equivalency table at 2D1.1 for ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, and PPA, is a 50% theoretical yield.
That's right. Now let's go on and talk about another one of the major changes. And I say major because this generated a lot of attention from the outside world. There was a lot of press coverage on this particular change, and that is the increased penalties for offenses involving ecstasy or MDMA. You may know that MDMA and some of its other like substances are actually a derivative of methamphetamine. It's just a little bit of a difference in the chemical structure there, but the base that you're starting with is methamphetamine. What is happening across the country is that a large number of teenagers and young adults are using this drug, and it's becoming very widespread, and Congress is very concerned about that. So in response to that concern and the Ecstasy Anti-Proliferation Act of 2000, the commission was given some directives for increasing the penalties for cases involving ecstasy. Now, prior to the changes that went into effect, actually May 1st, this was an emergency amendment authority change, the equivalency for 1 gram of ecstasy at the drug guideline was 35 grams of marijuana. And as you can see, the increase is quite great. 1 gram of ecstasy now equals 500 grams of marijuana. Just to put it in perspective as to where it fits on the table and how it's punished on the table, 1 gram of cocaine equals 200 grams of marijuana, and 1 gram of heroin equals 1 kilogram of marijuana. So it's kind of in the middle of those two. And it's punished much more severely than it was before. To put it in another perspective, you may also know that the majority of ecstasy is manufactured and also subsequently distributed for use in pill form. So if you're seeing more of these cases, you're most likely going to see cases involving large numbers of pills. So to put it in that sort of reference, 800 pills is going to get a 5-year sentence, and 8,000 pills is going to equal about a 10-year sentence. Mm-hmm. So that's what you're looking at there with offenses involving ecstasy. Now, there were also some changes regarding Schedule 1 and 2 substances. And what we've done here is we've increased the cap, or we've lifted the cap from level 20, and now you can go all the way up to a level 38 for these types of offenses. And this was in response to concern over really and truly the date rape drug, GHB. You may have heard of the date rape drug, GHB. We also found, doing our research for ecstasy, that GHB is also being used in conjunction with ecstasy. Since ecstasy is a derivative of methamphetamine, it puts you on a high, and some of these kids are using this GHB to come down off of the ecstasy. So obviously that's going to affect those types of cases as well. And other date rape drugs such as flunitrazepam, and of course any other Schedule 1 and 2 substance, will be affected by this, the lifting of this cap.
Mm-hmm. Now, not all of the amendments that we've made under the drug guideline or the list of chemical guideline were the result of congressional directives. We do have a couple of changes that were the result of commission initiatives. The first of these deals with defendants who qualify for the safety valve reduction under the drug guideline. That is the two-level reduction at 2D1.1B6. Previously, this reduction was only available to defendants whose offense level was a level 26 or greater. That floor has been erased. Now the safety valve is available to any defendant whose sentence is calculated under guideline 2D1.1, regardless of whether the defendant is subject to a mandatory minimum penalty or not. Now, related to this, guideline 5C1.2, the safety valve guideline itself, the commission has implemented a minimum floor offense level of 17 for those defendants who are subject to a mandatory minimum but still meet the criteria 1 through 5 under guideline 5C1.2. Now, the reason that this has been implemented is to more strictly comply with an instruction that Congress gave to us when they actually implemented the safety valve provision in the statute. Congress had stated that a sentence of 24 months would be appropriate for defendants who qualify for this relief under the safety valve. And if you look at your sentencing table, you will notice that in criminal history category 1, offense level 17, that is the first place on the sentencing table where a 24-month sentence is the minimum of the guideline range. And so that's why we've targeted that offense level 17, or made that floor under 5C1.2.
Okay, let's shift gears somewhat and let's talk about some of the changes that have occurred to the listed chemical guideline, which is found at 2D1.11. Now, these changes were made in conjunction with the changes for the lab operators and methamphetamine at 2D1.1, and also as a result of directives from the Methamphetamine Anti-Proliferation Act of 2000. And Congress was once again concerned about the production of methamphetamine, and as we know, there are precursors that are involved, precursor chemicals that are involved in the production of methamphetamine. So what we've done is we've increased the penalties for these three, or for actually all of the precursors, but there are three big precursors, we like to call them. Those are ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, and phenylpropanolamine. And what we've done is we've created a new chemical quantity table, a separate chemical quantity table, for these three precursors, the biggies if you will, at the listed chemical guideline at 2D1.11. And by doing that, we've increased maximum base offense levels for these types of offenses involving these types of listed chemicals from what was previously a 30 to now what is a level 38. We have also increased offense levels for other precursors that are involved in the production of methamphetamine, although you don't see them as often, and it typically requires a little bit more chemical expertise, if you will, to use some of these other precursors in the production of methamphetamine. Those, in response to Congress's concerns, those penalties have also been raised as well. Now, since we have pulled out these three precursors and put them into their separate little quantity table at 2D1.11, we no longer have a conversion table for other listed chemicals to ephedrine. If you will remember, there was a conversion table at 2D1.11 that worked in much the same way as the conversion table at 2D1.1, in that if you had multiple listed chemicals, you were to convert them all to ephedrine and then do your calculations for your offense level in that fashion. Well, since we no longer have that conversion table, we have new rules when you have a case involving multiple listed chemicals. The new rule is that the single listed chemical that provides the highest offense level is going to be used to determine the offense level in these types of cases at 2D1.11. So hopefully that'll clear that up for you. A couple of additional changes I'd like to touch on quickly is that we've added iodine and GBL to the precursor chemical table at 2D1.11. You may be aware already that iodine is used in the production of methamphetamine, and GBL is a precursor for GHB, which is the date rape drug that I had talked about earlier. In addition, there is a new offense that was created by Congress involving the transportation of anhydrous ammonia across state lines for purposes of producing methamphetamine. That new offense will be referenced in your Appendix A to Guideline 2D1.12.
Okay, thanks. Now, that brings us almost to a break, and it is time now for our questions and to take time to answer your questions that you might have. We did get a couple of faxes in. We're going to take some time to take a look at those and get an answer to you about those right after the break. But to start us off here, there was one question that I have heard the commission helpline has frequently received, Pam, is have any of these amendments been made retroactive?
No, Lauren. The commission decided this year not to make any of the amendments retroactive. Therefore, there are no new amendments to be added to Guideline 1B1.10.
Okay, great. Well, that answers that question. Now, there's a couple of other frequently asked questions that I think the helpline has been collecting since the amendments were proposed. So a couple of those. The first one has to do with the economic crimes, and this one will be directed to Krista. And the question here is, if the offense involves a telemarketing fraud and the defendant receives an enhancement for mass marketing under the Section 2B1.1B2A, can that defendant also receive an enhancement under Section 3A1.1 for targeting vulnerable victims?
Yes, as a matter of fact, if a defendant receives a two-level increase for mass marketing under the new 2B1.1 guideline, an additional increase under 3A1.1, the vulnerable victim guideline, can be applied for the defendant where the offense involves a vulnerable victim and if there was a large number of vulnerable victims involved in the offense. However, if a defendant receives a four-level increase under the new 2B1.1 guideline for having anywhere from more than 50 victims, the only available increase under the vulnerable victim guideline would be an additional two levels. So you can see, and this is listed specifically in an application note under 2B1.1, so basically, the maximum amount or the maximum number of levels that a defendant can receive for mass marketing and for vulnerable victim enhancement is a total of six. So if the defendant would receive a two-level increase for mass marketing, a possible four additional levels is available under Guideline 3A1.1. But if a defendant receives four levels under 2B1.1 for having an offense involving over 50 victims, only an additional two levels will be available under the vulnerable victim guideline.
Okay, great. Thanks, Krista. Now, the next question that we have here has to do with the drug guidelines that Krista and Rachel were just talking about. But Pam, I'm going to direct this question to you and ask, when applying Section 2D1.11, can a two-level reduction for the safety valve be applied as in Section 2D1.1?
Well, Lauren, it's not available. Unless the defendant who is would be cross-referenced out of 2D1.11, there's no specific offense characteristic in that listed chemical guideline for that safety valve reduction. It's only if there's a cross-reference because the offense involved the manufacturing of a controlled substance offense or the attempted manufacture of a controlled substance and the resulting offense level will be higher. It's only if the defendant is in Guideline 2D1.1 is that safety valve reduction available for a defendant who is not subject to a mandatory minimum but meets those five criteria in the safety valve.
Okay, so only under 2D1.1, not necessarily under 2D1.11,
right,
only with the cross-reference.
Correct.
Okay. Okay, great. Like I said, we did receive a couple of other faxes. We are going to get those answers for you right after the break, which we are going to take right now. And after the break, we will pick up the pace a little bit and move a bit more quickly through the rest of the amendments. So we'll see you in 10 minutes.